CTV. Good morning. The latest information I have on the projected federal deficit is not $10 billion, not $20 billion, but $30.5 billion. And much of it will come about because of the fact that businesses losing money hand over fist will be entitled to tax refunds in large quantities this year. So the feds are in trouble. We all know that Mr. Bennett is still teetering on the razor's edge about an election. And the Lord knows how long you can teeter on a razor's edge. And we know that he's telling us that his projected deficit will be anything up to $1 billion. So it's small potatoes to talk about Vancouver. But it's not small potatoes if you live in Vancouver. Because unless Vancouver cuts and slashes, they're going to have a $23 million city deficit in 1983. And here this morning to set the record straight about how he's going to cut and slash if he's re-elected is Mike Harcourt, the mayor of Vancouver. Also on the program this morning, perhaps with some good news, is a man who knows real estate in this part of the world. And his name is Kelly Heed. And he's a senior vice president of Macaulay, Nicolls and Maitland. But for lighter relief, because it's Friday, you may never have heard of Flashman. But you've certainly heard of George MacDonald Fraser, who, among other things, created a cult who are followers of the incredible Flashman. Flashman later. First, for the financial genius Harcourt, who thinks that Bear's a glib fibber, or a glibber Baker is a glibber fibber, or is capable of glib fibs, after the break. His worship, Mike Harcourt, the mayor of Vancouver. Do you accept the prediction of your finance man, Leckie, that in 1983 you will have a deficit of $23 million?
Well, that's not what Peter Leckie said, Jack. He said that we are going to face a revenue shortfall. That's his best guess.
Of how much?
Of $23 million.
Don't let's quibble about financial words.
Listen, that's a very real difference because, as you know, but some people don't in this city, including one of the mayoralty candidates, municipal governments cannot have a deficit. We, by law, have to balance our budget, and we do, and we will.
Okay, let me keep that clear.
Right.
You're going to be $23 million short next year.
That is the guesstimate. It may not be that way. There's two or three factors that may change.
It might be 20 or 25 million.
It
who knows?
It may be 10.
All right, now
but
what?
We will balance the budget.
You must be campaigning, therefore, on a balanced budget. What will you cut?
We will, as the finance director points out, cut the capital budget. We have already instructed our department heads to cut back on their departmental budgets, 3% or 6%. We'll choose in December, the new council will. And thirdly, that we will have to look at ways of increasing revenues. So there's all three of those are going to be
possible tax increases and possible service cuts.
To balance the budget. Now, it.
You have
tax
no
increase,
option. You must balance
the budget. We must
balance
the budget, and we will. Now, to carry that out, Jack, for this year, we put a hiring freeze in place at the beginning of the year. No hiring. As a matter of fact, we have had to let over 40 people go in sewers, police, fire, parks, health, a lot of the departments, we have let people off. And we'll have to do more.
Okay. That means that CUPE can look forward not even to 6% next year, but to no increase at all. CUPE and the Vancouver City Hall Employees Association.
That is going to have to go through the regular collective bargaining process. I'm not going to predict what the outcome will be. But again, we have provincial legislation in place there, as you know. restricting the increases of all public bodies to 6% and 5%.
Will you, for instance, next year, if you're reelected, wipe out the waste of money of $130,000 for this piece of nonsense called the Urban Reader, produced by civil servants at the City Hall?
Although that was created in the early part of the 1970s, and it's a small item that will probably be reduced or cut out,
but we're going to have to
eliminate, as I said before, somewhere between $10 and $23 million.
Will you eliminate the Urban Reader?
And we will do so. As a council, we may even make that decision in the next couple of weeks.
But would you recommend that this in-house magazine, which talks about the voteless in Liechtenstein and DDT snake oil and subways, women in Japan, India, and Liechtenstein, is that not a palpable, unnecessary expense which grew out of perhaps Baker's LIP money, which you should cut?
Yeah, what I have said in the past, Jack, is if it's a choice between the Urban Reader and five policemen, it's an obvious choice, the five policemen.
Now, Michael, I don't want to make a big thing about this.
Yeah.
Do you regard this thing as a totally unnecessary public expense?
I don't regard it as a significant item at City Hall. It's not a major, it's not an essential service. It's one of the areas that we are probably going to have to chop.
$130,000 for this?
Yeah. Well, as I said, we're going to have to chop all non-essentials.
Are you going to chop this?
That's what the Finance Committee is dealing with right now.
Will you recommend that that be chopped?
And Council, on probably the 5th of October, will make that decision.
See, I was taught as a very small boy in Scotland, if you look after the pennies, the pounds will take care of themselves. And this is one of the pennies.
Well,
you
as
can
you know,
down
as
drain.
You know, I am a quarter Scot myself, and this is one of the areas that we've taken a very firm hand on all the way during the last 2 years, Jack, is not only save the pennies, but save the hundreds of millions, too, as we did when we renegotiated
Except
the big projects.
Except for the $130,000 you didn't save last year on this.
Well, as I said, this year it's a good candidate for chopping.
Good. Now, your opposition's a fellow, what's his name?
Jonathon.
Jonathon what?
Jonathon Halfbaker, you mean?
Jonathon Halfbaker. All right.
No, Jonathon is, Jonathon has
why
been,
is he a glib fibber?
Has been, well, he's been around a long time. Not as experienced in terms of running the city.
But a former bureaucrat who knows where the skeletons are buried.
Well, who built the Granville Mall, which of course is a fabulous success in this city.
It's a disaster.
But what I'm upset about, and let's admit it, Jack, the campaign doesn't start till October the 25th. That's when nominations close. I'm still not sure who are going to be candidates for mayor to run against me until October the 25th.
Are you going to be?
Absolutely.
Well, regardless, you've got to answer the charges.
And the charge that he's made are glib fibs.
Okay, he said there was a somebody, the highest paid bureaucrat, got more than $100,000. Is that not true?
He said all the high paid bureaucrats at City Hall making over $100,000 should be stopped. There is not one bureaucrat at City Hall making over $100,000.
What is the highest paid bureaucrat at City Hall?
$98,000. Fritz Bauer is the city's manager.
$98,000?
With a budget of $262 million, over 6,000 employees, most of them police, fire, engineering works, the most important city in this country's economic recovery. It's a big, big enterprise.
Have you cut any senior salaries at City Hall?
We've had rollbacks this year
of
all senior salaries of 1.3%, including the mayor's.
1.3%? So therefore, Bowers would lose $1,300.
And there's a freeze on everybody.
$1,300 to cut his salary by.
Right, and there's a freeze on everybody.
All right, 500 new positions created at the City Hall in the past 10 years while the population has dropped 3%. He accuses you of feather bedding. Not you, but the growth over 10 years.
That's another nonsense statement.
Nonsense.
And it shows his inexperience or his glib fibs. It's got to be either one of the two. We have, over the last 4 years, had 250 people added to City Hall.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's eliminate 30 of those because they're meter maids who are going to cost about $750,000 and make $2.5 to $3.5 million in revenue. Okay? So let's say we've had 220 added to City Hall.
Mm-hmm.
Now, 210 of those were added under Jack Vollridge and George Puel.
But you'll cut them out if
we've
necessary.
We've already cut. We have cut 46 people out over the last year with a freeze on all hiring. And with the process we're going to go through to balance our budget, Jack, we are going to have to make further reductions by attrition, by a whole bunch of measures that we're discussing with the unions and department heads and council right now?
If you're reelected and there is a QP, a City Hall union strike next year, will you go, will you not cross the picket line unless you have a picket pass from the union?
Well, I don't think there'll be a strike next year.
Michael, you're a liar.
That, Jack, and on top of that, I have made my position clear right from the beginning that I am the elected mayor of this city. The government of Vancouver will continue, period. And that means running the city hall, that means running the council.
Does it mean crossing a picket line if necessary?
Yeah, absolutely, and I expect that
without a permit from the picket captain.
Absolutely, and what I have said though in the past is that I had a pass from the unions as a matter of courtesy to carry on the business of the city, and that we had a small incident in the last strike that was a misunderstanding, but I intend to run this city. I made that very clear.
I'm going to go straight to the phones this morning because, after all, we want a nice, bright, lively civic election, don't we? I mean, you're quite confident at the moment that you'll just trample all over this amateur Baker.
Oh, I'm not confident at all,
yes,
Jack.
Yes, you are.
Well, listen, I think it's going to be a close election, and I'm fighting hard.
I can sometimes be kind of rough with you, but I called him an ex-Yankee flute player. So, I mean, even Stephen. So let me ask you this before I go to the phones. You used to endorse Gay Unity Week, but you cancelled it this year. You didn't give them the declaration.
Oh, that's just nonsense.
Is that not
true?
I issued
the same statement this year as I did last year, which said very simply, I don't believe in gay rights. I don't think there's any special rights for people in this society. There's human rights, and if you're law-abiding people, you're entitled to the same protection all of us are.
Oh, I thought there had been a Gay Unity Week, which you proclaimed one year.
It's another glib
fib. You didn't.
I issued the same statement this year as I did last year.
Okay, off the hook on that one. Phones to Mike Harcourt after the break. Before I go to the phones, just a couple of soft questions to Mike, based, I hope, on some reason and knowledge. Would you not concede, Your Worship, that the four-day week is really a great inconvenience, especially among senior staff, because you've got your two council meetings, you've got Mondays, you've got people taking the fourth day and Friday, and it's very difficult to get committees together and get things done.
No, I don't agree, Jack. Most of the city, for example, is not on a four-day work week.
I'm talking about the city.
No, but I'm saying that three-quarters of the city staff are in regular shifts. Mm-hmm. The four-day work week extends the hours of service at City Hall an hour, which is for the convenience of citizens, so that citizens can come in before they go to work or on their way home.
I know all the theory,
okay, but
it's not a handicap.
No, it's not. It's a fact. We've reviewed it. We've found the areas where it doesn't work effectively, and we've eliminated those areas. Mm-hmm. Now, we hold our committee meetings on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursdays, in any event, mm-hmm. with Monday and Friday as preparatory days, as getting ready.
Basically,
for the meetings.
Then, you still support the four-day week.
Well, so do most enterprises. Most large corporations use the four-day work week for a whole variety of reasons. Mm-hmm. So we're not unique. Mm-hmm. It's not just Vancouver City that's doing extended hours for better service to the public.
Now, I'd like to look into camera number two when it comes up and give your specific appeal to all of Rankin's supporters and Erickson and York's supporters in Cope, so that they know that you are with Harry, you and Walker and Ewart and Yee, that you're there is a solid slate of the left wing. Now, they want to be unfair, but here's a free commercial plug for you.
He says he's going to retire every year, you know, and he'll outlast all of us. When I'm still playing golf, retired on North Pender, you'll be doing this same cheeky program, Jack.
I like Harry Rankin. I wouldn't vote for him, but I like him. And it's a pity you can't get a decent NDP-type slate to run for all the seats in council, isn't it?
Well, you know that I've run as an independent for the last three elections. I'm running again this time.
Correct.
I am very proud of the fact that I have the endorsation of the trade union movement.
Yeah.
And that I am running with three other independents, Carol Walker, Bill Yee, Eric Ewart, all three good, solid, sensible people.
And I think you should welcome the support of Cope, shouldn't you?
And I have the backing of a number of organizations in this city.
Including Cope.
Including Cope, who, by the way, on a number of issues like wards, affordable housing, tax reform, good transit, we agree. Now, we have large areas of disagreement too, which is why I'm an independent.
Good. Independent and of NDP background. And
sure.
Can't be ashamed of being an
absolutely.
NDP.
Absolutely. I have that background. I have the trade union support, community groups, ethnic groups.
It's like motherhood.
A lot of people.
Now, first call to, and you get mad when they call you Harcourt.
Well, that's a cheap shot.
Cheap shot.
Yeah.
Like glib fib.
Glib fib. Cheap shot.
Cheap shot.
It's a half-bakered idea.
Cheap shot. You've kept your sense of humor, Michael. Go ahead, please. That's you.
Yes, I'd like to make, I'd like to hear some comments from you about Mr. Jonathon Baker's comments with regards to the cost overruns that are being experienced by City Hall. Now, I might add, I find these comments of his rather amusing, as his non-entity partisan association have the majority on City Council.
And have had for the last 4 years. Well, there are no cost overruns, sir. We have cut back this year substantially, and we are preparing the new council, when they come in December, to deal with any deficits so that we will have a balanced budget come January the 1st. There will be no cost overruns. There will be no deficit. There will be a balanced budget and some harsh trimming that will have to take place to maintain the essential services that people in Vancouver want.
Go ahead to Mike Harcourt.
Morning, Mr. Harcourt. I have
morning, sir.
To agree with a couple things you said the other night. It's with deep sadness that I agree with, I disagree with your point of view that people are going to be safe on the streets of Vancouver, because they're not. You know, we have crime in this society.
Yes, we do. I agree with you, sir. We do.
In the municipality, what we have to concern ourselves with is the reasons for crime. And most immediately,
unemployment.
We have to see that the Vancouver City Police stop harassing the young generation like they do, bringing the administration of justice into disrepute, which is causing these people to not respect
the law. Let me test this call. Are you the gentleman who interminably phones everyone about the relaxation of the marijuana laws?
I am.
You are, sir?
I am.
Thank you very much. He has a problem, and he may have a point or two, but he's totally off the topic, Your Worship, if you'll allow me to take that away.
Please do.
Go ahead, please.
Thank you.
Yes.
I have a question for Mike. Mr. Harcourt, can you tell me, you're talking about between $10 million and $23 million having to be cut.
Right.
How do you justify things such as in the West End with the cul-de-sacs and the changes in the street?
Well, there's about $6 million. That is being spent on street improvements in the West End. The justification, sir, is that those streets are 50 years out of date. $5.2 million is being spent strictly fixing up the streets and the curbs and the street lighting and the sidewalks.
And the mini parks?
Is about $800,000, a good portion of which is paid for by the on the local improvement program. The reason for that program, sir, is to bring some peace and quiet and some tranquility to the people in the West End who are plagued by the street soliciting that's going on, by cars roaring through the West End. And my major commitment that I've had, as Jack knows, since I started with Darlene, Missouri, are to peaceful, stable neighborhoods throughout the city of Vancouver.
It's very difficult. Let me mention Kavanaugh, who's going to whip up all the West Side votes and taking away the nonsensical barriers in Shaughnessy. And he's got a good issue there, because these barriers were a laughable business in Shaughnessy.
I don't agree with you,
they?
Jack.
You don't
no,
agree with
I don't
me.
Agree with you.
Well, you've got to protect Shaughnessy.
I think we...
You and Harry have got to look after the quiet of the neighborhood streets in Shaughnessy.
In Shaughnessy, Mount Pleasant, Strathcona, the West End, Champlain Heights, all over the city, where commuter traffic starts to ravage individual neighborhoods, we have taken action to make sure that neighborhoods remain safe and quiet and peaceful. We have done it throughout the city.
And you can't do it next year because you won't have the money for that kind of thing next year.
There's no requests for any other of these traffic measures anywhere else in the city.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, I'm speaking to the twat Jack.
Yes?
Yeah. I tried to get you, Jack, when you had Mr. Baker on.
Get to the point, please.
All right, he made a statement that during the last depression, and I wanted to ask him where the hell he was during the last depression, but he made a statement that everybody took cutbacks. You couldn't even buy a job in the last depression.
Well, sir, we don't need history now. We're not going to have a depression like that again. We're going to talk about taxis and businessmen, however, after the break.
Wow.
Well, it's nice to know, Your Worship, running for re-election, that you're going to trim some of the fat at City Hall, even though you don't admit it's in any of the places that Baker says it is. You are going to trim fat. You know, will you consider...
Of course we will, Jack. I mean, people are hurting. And when you run a city as prosperous and as successful over the years as Vancouver, and you get into tough times, you realize people can't afford any new services, that they can't afford any tax increases, so you trim. And we're doing that. But, you know, we're not doing it as a short-term political...
I wish you hadn't mentioned tax increases, because I'm going to slap up on the screen now...
The commercial taxes.
Taxes, now, it's an unusual one. It's a racquetball academy, Bill Weaver.
Sure, I've talked to him.
Yeah, you talked to him. Well, just look at his problem.
Oh, they're savage.
Jack, this is not a unique story, but it illustrates a very big problem facing Vancouver businessmen. A year ago, the Racquetball Academy opened beneath the Bentall Four Tower in downtown Vancouver in the prestigious Golden Triangle District. At the time, the three businessmen expected to pay about $30,000 in business and property taxes. But in the last 6 months, the city has more than doubled that. The three brothers who own the place are now faced with a bill of over $68,000. Here's what their tax bill looks like. Property taxes, $3,308 a month for an annual total of $39,696. Add to that a bill last March for $11,610 from the city for business taxes. And yet another bill for $16,859.53 received on August 31st for an increase in their property taxes. That brings the total bill to $68,165.53. Bill Weaver is one of three brothers who own the Racquetball Academy.
What's really at stake? How many people are on? Do you employ?
We have 20 full-time jobs here, and these are jobs for young people. There's only one person here with a full-time job over the age of 30.
You know, we keep hearing from the city at the same time, you know, well, they need the bucks too, so they've got an expensive city to run here. And what do you say to them?
Well, I think they could run their operation more efficiently, and I think that some city services could be cut, and they could certainly eliminate the business tax.
What would you like to see done? What have you said to the mayor?
Amongst other things, I've suggested that, similar to the federal and provincial breaks which are given to young businesses in terms of income tax, that a similar provision should be made for beginning businesses like ours. This business had no taxable income last year.
The business itself had no taxable income?
Had no taxable income, and yet the taxes by the city of Vancouver alone in our first year were $68,000.
Can you pay it?
We've paid almost $50,000 of this in installments. And we received this last bill for $16,800 about 2 weeks ago. And it's going to be very difficult to pay this bill.
Could you be forced out of business?
It's certainly possible, but we'll try very hard not to be.
Sure, that was a new business, and that's a good times business and expensive property. But the figure $68,000, how much of that would be in school taxes?
Oh, probably 60 to 70% would be school tax, the BC Assessment Authority, the Urban Transit Authority, the Regional Hospital District Levy. About a third would be the cost of our police, fire, engineering, basic
city
services.
We've really gone over the odds, haven't we? We've gone over the odds.
Oh, these people got savage, Jack. And as a council, we, for the last few years, have been saying to the provincial government to avoid this kind of a huge increase in taxes, number one, give us a differential mill rate so that if commercial values go way up and residential values way down like this year, we can even it off.
Because actually it was the businesses that got what's the
absolutely
one,
residentials went down this year because of their value. We didn't get that change from the provincial government. We could have cut that in, we could have cut that tax down considerably this year with that. Now secondly, we said to the provincial government, you should not finance our school system out of the property tax. Introduce the recommendations of McMath.
That's for the future. You know what
But the other thing they did, Jack, is in the short term, provincial government shifted the tax burden onto the commercial, industrial, and off of residential, and it clobbered people like Bill Weaver, who, by the way, I grew up with. I've known Bill and his family for years.
If Bennett finally gets off the razor's edge, the NDP will walk away with it, won't they?
Oh, sure. People are tired of being savaged by a lack of action by the provincial government.
Okay.
And that's unanimous opinion of our council.
Harcourt predicts easy NDP win.
No, I didn't say that. I think it's going to be a toss of the coin.
You said sure when I asked you.
No, I said if there was a change, it's an issue that is affecting the public, the school taxes.
Believe it or not, I've got sympathy for all of you. I wouldn't be a politician with decisions to make for all the tea in China.
I'll tell you something. If you're the mayor of Vancouver, it's an exciting job. It's a pleasant city, even in tough times.
Yeah,
I wouldn't be running again if I didn't think so.
Promise you'll cut out this. Go ahead, please.
Mayor Harcourt, I want to know, what are you going to do about these families that work at the City Hall? I know personally of three generations that work there. And in your last civic strike, a woman came on television.
Just a minute.
Reporter, and she said she was so proud of the fact that her husband worked there, and her son worked there, and her daughter worked there. And apparently you don't have to have any brains to work at City Hall. All you have to have is an uncle or an aunt.
Well.
Like the fire department used to be.
That's the sort of slandering of the public service.
But is it true?
That's
well,
the kind
it's
of
true
slander.
Because I know of that personally.
Listen,
three generations that work there.
I think that people are proud of public service, deserve a pat on the back rather than the kick
in
the behind.
Why don't you have the same policy that Eaton's have? If I work at Eaton's, none of my relatives get a job there. Now, you can't tell me you can't enforce
ma'am,
that.
Ma'am, we have a merit hiring system. If people are qualified, you shouldn't discriminate against them just because somebody else works there. They have
it's
to...
It's pull, isn't
they
it?
Have, no, it's not at all.
Oh,
there
it is pull because I
not,
know
ma'am.
For a fact that it's pull.
No, it's not. And I'll tell you about the families. It was your first question at City Hall. I'm not going out bashing the public service. We're going to make trims, and we're going to do it through attrition. We're going to do it through a whole bunch of measures so we can maintain as many jobs as possible, not get rid of the basic services people want in terms of fire and police and engineering services.
Oh, no.
But it's going to be a tough year for everybody.
Ma'am, when you talk about three generations, you mean working at the same time, grandfather, father, and son?
No.
The grandfather worked there, and then the son worked there, and then his son worked there.
Right.
Oh, that's fair enough. They won it by merit competition. There was no drag, you silly, suspicious woman. You can't avoid that, I don't suppose.
No, it's a good sport now to bash public service.
I understand.
But I'm getting a little tired of it.
I understand your social planning place is still a little bit of a retirement home. It's grown 31% in 10 years. Now, I never did know what they do there, even when Baker was there. Baker spent $800,000 in federal grants for all these funny little paintings and sculptures. Remember during the LIP days?
Oh, that was, sure. Instead of creating real jobs for people, they created these frilly little projects.
Have you done the same at City Hall? Has the City Hall, not you.
No, we've cut back a lot of
have I time for one more segment?
Services.
Yes, I can do one quick segment with... His Worship Mike Harcourt loved that call from that woman, and it's not really a slander. You know, you and I know happened.
Well, let's put it this way. When she...
It's like the BC Ferries.
When she says that the public servants are hired because they know somebody, that's just not true, Jack. We've got a very strong...
Nowadays.
Not at all. We've got
nowadays,
a strong merit system.
A better chance to be hired if you're a member of a minority. Right?
Nasty crack.
Is it a crack?
No, it's not. You don't
surely you're giving
chance.
Some token hiring to minorities as part of your NDP policy.
No, what we've said... is that City Hall should be based on the same opportunities and there shouldn't be any barriers to people and that we remove the barriers and then it's open, fair competition.
Another segment with Mike Harcourt. Not too long, but he's in good form this morning and so are the callers. After the break.
Nature captured in a unique white wine. Schloss Latterheim, nurtured to perfection from a blend of carefully selected premium grapes. Light tasting, mellow, splendid, delightful. Schloss Latterheim, experience the glory of nature.
Bridge of talent is.
Go ahead to Mike Harcourt, please.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I saw you on TV the other night, and you talked at the beginning of the show about how the city wasn't going to be run by the big developers, and you also said that you'd take a hard stand on your bargaining with them.
Right.
The Bank of BC was going to put a big tower in Georgia and Hornby, and the project got slowed down by numerous red tape and social planning.
It got slowed down, sir, by the economy.
Is that what your hard bargaining achieves, Mr. Mayor?
Oh, well, sir, you unfortunately have a very mistaken view of what happened there. And, you know, from your question, obviously, you phoned in with a political viewpoint.
Why shouldn't he?
Absolutely. Well, I'm just making it clear.
He said that City Hall paperwork delayed the Bank of BC building enough for it to be caught up in the economic recession.
No, that's not true. That's not true. The Bank of BC is going to go ahead with that building.
When?
They're going to build a theater for the city. They're going to have the extra floor space ratio, and they have pulled back on building that building, like most other major developers, until the economy improves, interest rates come down, and there is no glut of office space on the market. Now, to blame the city for that is to blame the mouse for being trampled on by the elephant being inflation, high interest rates, and a slowdown in the economy.
Okay, let him have a word. Go ahead, caller.
Well, I know, but the project was going to go ahead, but because of the slowdowns, the economy turned around in the middle of the process.
Oh, sir,
it would have been under
true.
Construction now, and they would have been committed, and it probably would be ready at the end of this year or early next year.
That's just
but
not true.
Because the economy turned around in the middle of the red tape process, it slowed down then.
But that's a good point he brings up about the big projects and what we've been able to do there, Jack. Over the last 2 years...
Right, for instance, your total endorsation of False Creek Stadium has been wonderfully helpful, I'm sure, to Hardman, Nerod and company.
What has happened with the large projects is that instead of them being a multi-million dollar burden for the taxpayers, the property taxpayers in Vancouver, they're now not going to cost us a sou.
Except for the Cambie Street Bridge.
Which we're going to have to rebuild anyways.
Are you going to... Do you recommend people vote for the Cambie Street Bridge?
Yes.
I think it's $6 million.
Yes.
Are you not now proud of that magnificent stadium with the roof going up?
Jack, you and I did a program 4 years ago when I said build the stadium downtown, not out at the PNE. I was the first politician in this city to say put the stadium downtown. Link it to a Pier BC Trade and Conference Center by a good rapid transit system.
You're younger than me. You've got
4 years ago.
I can't contradict you. I'll take your word for it. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Harcourt. A man in City Hall making $98,000 a year, and you give him a $1,300 cutback. Do you really feel that's fair at this time of the way the economics are?
Well, we're probably going to have a freeze and possible other cutbacks next year, sir. You have to realize that the city manager in Vancouver is in charge of the third largest urban area in the country with a staff of 6,000 people.
You've said that.
With a budget of $262 million, with a number of major projects.
Mayor Harcourt thinks that $98,000 is a proper salary $100 cut for the guy who used to be an alderman and became city manager.
I'm saying that the city manager of Vancouver, whoever he is,
can't get less than $98,000.
Has a very important position. And if you compare that position to a comparable one in private industry, the comparison is that the city manager in Vancouver is making somewhere around $100,000 less than his counterpart in private industry.
Was. This counterpart in private industry has been given a minor golden handshake and laid off.
No, his counterpart in private industry is the executive officer of the company.
Oh, you're on the spot on that one, Mike. It's an embarrassing question for you. You better just leave it at that. You're not going to cut
it. It's not an embarrassing question.
You're certainly not going to cut the, his name, Bowers back to a reasonable $75,000 or anything. You couldn't do that.
It's not an embarrassing question at all, Jack.
And he deserves in the end his $98,000, doesn't he?
He works a 70-hour a week in the largest city in this province.
He's not going to say he deserves it?
I think Fritz does a damn good job.
And
sure,
he deserves the $98,000.
I think he works hard, and he works hard for his money and for the people of Vancouver.
You're a little bit slow to defend him.
As I said, he deserves the support of the people of Vancouver and not the kind of cheap knocks that he's getting right now.
Why do people like you go into public life and subject yourself to cheap knocks such as I've been known to give you for
time? You don't give me cheap knocks because I know every one I get a stroke off you in the golf course. I just save them up.
You're a balding, aging do-gooder who's done not a bad job as mayor for the last couple of years, but why bother? Wouldn't it be better to write your law business?
Because it's a great city. It's a great city, and we've got lots of future ahead of us, and I want to be part of that.
And just by the way, Bruce Erickson, your good friend, just phoned up off the air. He wants you to spell out specifically the areas in which you disagree with your running mates and cope.
Well, we'll sit down and have a coffee with him at
City
Hall.
Have a coffee with him.
Sure.
You had coffee with him every
morning
for years.
Listen, I talk to those people every Tuesday. I'd much rather talk to the public.
Good idea.
Right.
And policy should be made in open line shows, as Bill Vanderzam says, and not in secret meetings of the city council. Go ahead, please.
Mayor Harcourt?
Yes, ma'am.
How much has the city lost in selling land to co-ops as to what they would get if they sold the land on the open market? And
yes.
Can you tell us the income range of the tenants in, say, the Marina
yes.
co-op and the Kinross Creek co-op? And
yes.
also tell us what the rents are in those cooperatives.
Well, ma'am, I can
too many poor in them.
I can say, first of all, we don't sell our land to co-ops. We give 40-year leases. We give 40-year leases, usually at market rates. The people who are living in the co-ops, three-quarters of them are making under $25,000 a year in family income.
You're sure of those figures?
Those figures are now coming before council and a report being prepared by our staff because of people like yourself who think that there are a lot of wealthy people living in co-ops. Now, the reason there are people living in co-ops who have incomes above that is because the provincial government cut off the subsidies to the low-income families, the mothers with single parents, the disabled, the senior citizens. And so you require some higher-income people in the co-op to subsidize the lower-income senior citizens.
That sounds like
that's what the rents are, Mayor Harcourt.
The rents are geared to 25% of people's income.
Give us some figures. There's a very small percentage, 15%, pay on that basis.
No,
the rest of the people pay the top scale. Please tell us the top scale.
Well, I can get that information for you, ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am, would you get that information for me, too?
I'm in the system, Mr. Harcourt.
Okay, look, ma'am, hold on, please. I want Mark Schneider to talk to you about that, and then we can go back to the mayor with details.
Yep.
Good call, but I'm out of time. Do not hang up. Well, Mike, the campaign hasn't really started yet.
Well, we'll be back, Jack, next week. And then, of course, the campaign really doesn't get going until October the 25th when the nominations close.
My thanks to Mayor Harcourt. Next, I'm going to talk to Kelly Heed of Macaulay, Nicolls, and Maitland to get a kind of analytical view of whether or not you should buy or try to sell a house after the break. It's just about time that I had a man who knows the Lower Mainland real estate market, the BC real estate market. And so I've got Kelly Heed, who is the Senior Vice President for BC for real estate for Macaulay, Nicolls, and Maitland. Now, when was the big boom?
Well, Jack, the big boom, you know, we've had a couple, I guess, in the last 10 years. The first one in that 72-74 period where the prices went up like 80%, but people never really thought too much about it because at that time, a house was really very cheap. You know, you at the income levels, it was a good buy. And then for 5 years, it kind of just stayed stagnant. It went up maybe 4 or 5, kind of the inflation rate, maybe a little less than the inflation rate for about 5 years. So there was quite a pent-up demand that built up. And with a static supply, it started to move in 79. 78, 79, we had the economy was rolling.
Booming, everything was booming.
People were coming into the province in droves.
And it started to collapse, about a year ago?
A little more than a year ago. It started, the peak was kind of March, April, 81, and then it started to slow.
All right, how much has it collapsed? Give me an idea, really, from your clinical point of view, just how disastrous the collapse has been.
Well, it's always nice to play with numbers. On the way up, you could say that the prices went up 100% inside of a year. If you went through 1980, the prices literally went up 100%. In other words, they doubled. They've come down 50%, which is the same because they've dropped in half almost in some areas. But I think on an average, they've come down about 35%.
So therefore, a house that was worth, we'll say, nothing was worth $100,000, $200,000 at the top of the boom. If it were a desirable house, what could you sell it for now?
110.
110?
Right.
How many people, other than professionals, were trapped in the flips, and what the devil are they doing now?
Well, not the beauty of it. I'm really against speculation in housing, especially holding housing off the market. And that's what happened when it reached the top. But fortunately, there weren't that many sales at the top of the market. The number of sales when things really peaked came down quite drastically. So the numbers of sales on the way up were a lot. And then when the game got rolling, the speculators got in. Of course, the banks are easy to lend money. even the real estate companies got trapped. Of course, they were guaranteeing sales, they were offering interim financing, and so they got trapped, the speculators got trapped, and some fancy home buyers as well. Some people thought, well, I bought a house, mine is going to continue to rise, why hurry to sell it? They got trapped, which is unfortunate.
And then came the inflation rates and mortgages, then came the layoffs and the unemployment.
That's
and
right.
many people must now be in houses in which they cannot hope to pay the mortgages.
True, and some of the government programs, of course, didn't help. The AHOP program that CMHC had, they thought they gave them the carrot to say, look, why not get into a house at a lower rate, and when you start making more money, we'll increase your payments, which you know really didn't help because now the wage scales have leveled off, and they're walking from their homes.
Matt, if you haven't got a two-income family now, you can't afford to buy a house, can you, for the ordinary average person?
Well, now you can. You know, now it's back down to a level where the first-time buyer, which is so critical to the housing game, can get in, where he was the one that got stripped. When the speculators came in, the first-time buyer got stripped right out of the market.
And many people sold their houses and reinvested or sold their houses and put the money away. They'd be all right.
Very few, though. I mean, not, if they did, sure, they'd be in great shape, but most people traded. They traded equities, so, but Jack, if you look at it over the last 4 years, and you mentioned your example, if you bought a house 4 years ago, it's still worth 30 or 40% more than what you paid 4 years ago, so that's not a bad gain.
Yeah, but what I cry about at night is that if I'd sold at the top of the market, I'd have got 100% on it.
Well, Jack, you weren't planning on retiring or going into a rental spot anyways.
No, I tried the rental spot and that was quite fatal.
Yeah.
Now, are we at the bottom? Now, forget you're a real estate man. If you were buying a house now and you were a middle income or an average income person, would you buy a house now?
Yes, I would. I think...
How much would you pay for it? Now, I'm talking about a house, say, anywhere in any good, reasonable district, not fancy district, east or west Vancouver. How much would I have to pay for that house?
Well, the good examples, I guess, are the markets that are really coming back activity-wise, because the prices aren't going to go up that much in the short run. But the areas of the west side of Vancouver and north Vancouver are two very good examples of where homes were up as high as $190,000. And these are 33-foot lot bungalows have come down to that $110,000 level. Actually, North Van, the average sale price right now is 107, which is less than the average in the lower mainland. So North Van is good buying, and so is the west side of Vancouver.
Well, west side of Vancouver, what would the average there be now for the ordinary house?
The average house is selling. It's misleading because the larger homes aren't selling. So the average sales now are in that 100, 115,000 range.
Now you say a 33-foot lot. When that one went for 190,000, that was crazy, wasn't it?
Well, it was. The lot price, people were tearing down houses and buying lots for 180. You'd buy a little bungalow with a house on it. And really, land prices are based on what a house will sell for. So all of a sudden, the lot that they thought was worth $180,000, that were going to put a house on it, that builder, of course, that put the $40,000 house on, or $50,000 house, has now lost $120,000 almost.
Now, a 33-foot lot today with a small house on it would be back down to less than $100,000.
There are some that are down to less than $100,000. I'd say that if it was a lot with no value to the house on it, it's less than $100,000.
Are there still places where you could pick up a house for $80,000? The cheapest
yes.
new. What's the cheapest new house you've seen around?
Well, the new houses are... If a builder was selling a new house for less than $80,000, he's losing money. Because he obviously, when he built the house or bought the lot, he paid a top price. In Surrey, the lots are up to $70,000, $80,000. I mean, they're down now to maybe a realistic $30,000, $35,000, which allows the builder to put a house on to sell it for $80,000.
So this is a significant thing.
Not making money, though.
Lot prices, or vacant lot prices, or near vacant lots, there was only a real little shack on it, are down from these hysterical 70,000 levels to 30,000.
That's right. That's right. So now it allows the first-time buyer, and that's the young professional or the working couple, to invest in a house, which people still want, and it starts the chain rolling.
Might have some time for some calls to Kelly Heed. I have a few more questions to ask him about mortgaging at the moment after the break. Kelly Heed of Macaulay, Nicolls, Maitland. Now, Kelly, when you say that real estate is on the move, maybe you mean that instead of 10 sales last month, you made 15. There's no appreciable move to sell residential houses at the moment,
is there? You're wrong, Jack. Actually, the months of August and particular September there are more sales in the MLS board than at the peak levels of 1980 and 81. It really is surprising. I don't think it'll sustain itself, but the first time buyers are coming in droves, where in August the sales were almost 1,000 homes sold, and I think in September, the way the numbers are going, they'll be up over 1,200 and possibly close to 1,500.
You remember when executives refused to move here from the east because of the price of houses? Would that still apply?
It doesn't anymore. I think, although you won't see that many people coming into BC.
How about offshore buying? Remember when people were coming in from the Orient, and if you showed a house in West Vancouver of 50 people, 40 would be from Southeast Asia and they'd buy it for cash. Are these halcyon days still here for the real estate man?
Yeah, I don't think that's a little overplayed, Jack. There are buyers that do come in. What they typically do is that a house is a safe investment for them to make. A lot of them have family going to school, taking training here, and what have you.
And if you come from Hong Kong, our prices are dirt cheap.
Well, that's right. Yes, they are.
There's still some of that money coming in.
There is. Yes, there is.
Mortgaging now. If you were actively selling me, trying to con me in to buy a house in which to live, what would you advise me on mortgaging?
What I'd advise you, especially if you're a first-time buyer, is to take advantage of all the grants that are available. You can literally get into a condominium priced at $50,000 without putting any money up if it's a new development. So a family buying can take advantage of the provincial grant, they can take advantage of the federal grant, or if they don't want the grant, they can take advantage of a second mortgage. And now the province is coming out with the interest deduction program.
Just to gossip for a minute, I remember Fotheringham ran a story that Poole had sold his house. Poole had not sold his house. You haven't heard of it's been sold, have you?
I don't think he has sold, no.
No. Okay. Go ahead to... Oh, you didn't answer me about mortgaging. Do you think that mortgage rates now are still, what, 16 or 17?
Yeah, the mortgage rates vary. They're in the 16s now, so they're below 17%.
Could you go for a six-month, a one-year, or a five-year mortgage?
I'd take advantage of the owners carrying some financing right now. I think people
motivated for sale bit.
That's right. The motivated sellers, of course, that have to sell or are moving out of the area, then...
Could you blackjack them down to 12%?
For a short period of time. I would, because the rates, I think, will come down another couple of points.
Go ahead, please.
Great. I was married, and I've had two different houses, and now if I'm remarried, do I still qualify for the first home buyer's grant?
No, you don't. The provincial grant, have you ever had a grant before?
No.
No, you have to be a first-time buyer so that...
A first-time buyer in a new home or a first-time buyer, period?
Well, the grant, the provincial grant, which is the either the $1,000 or the $2,500, really, it varies the federal grant is the one that has a differential between the first-time buyer. The first-time buyer can buy new or used to get the $3,000 grant. The second-time buyer can take advantage of the $3,000 grant, providing it's a new home.
Oh, providing it's a new home.
Yes.
And would he also qualify for the first-time provincial, $1,000 or $2,500?
Yes, you can. You can take both.
$10,000 second mortgage?
No, the provincial is either or. Either you take the grant or you take the $10,000 second mortgage.
Thank you, sir. Now, Whistler, I hear that they're giving away stuff at Whistler. Are you aware of that at all?
No, I don't think they're giving away stuff at Whistler. I think that there's stuff on the market where there's very little equity left so that you can take over the mortgages.
I mean, if somebody's really strapped and all they've got is mortgages, they've lost their equity on the old boom, and you take over the mortgage, you can walk away.
Yeah, the banks will allow you in with no money down.
Do you go to a bank for that, or do you go to real estate for that?
No, they go to the finance company, whoever's financed the development. But the equity, what's happened is that the equity's come out of the buildings.
The owner's just lost his equity.
That's right.
And he wants to get off the hook for his payments.
That's right.
Is that not cruel to do that?
Well, it's not cruel to do that. The banks really haven't been that tough with people, providing you've been honest with them. You know, I think if you warn them in advance that, look, I'm having trouble, can you give me some sort of a deal to ease me through the pain? Mm-hmm. And they'll do it. They're not running out to foreclose.
Go ahead, please.
Jack, Mr. Heed never pinpointed when he felt the next boom might be. He thought that to purchase a house in the short run, you wouldn't see any initial gain. I've just purchased a house in North Van, and I just wondered when I thought I might be able to see a gain in this.
I think that it's always tough to predict the next boom, and it really doesn't help too many people when the boom does happen, because as many people get hurt as gained by it. I would say that we have to see a strong forestry sector, mining sector, where jobs firm up, people start coming into the province. It's strictly a supply and demand situation, so that over the next couple or 3 years, I think we hope for enough gain so that it outstrips inflation and everyone thinks that buying a house and owning a house is a nice, comfortable situation.
Go ahead, please. That's you.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm just going to ask my question, then hang up. I was talking to my sister who lives in a small town in Illinois last night, and she was telling me about a house that sold there, about 2,000 square feet, new, almost new, and with a rock fronting, you know, quite an elegant house. She said it sold for $27,000. Now, this is such a huge discrepancy between the prices we pay out here that I wondered where the answer lies. And do you, by any chance, know it?
Okay.
I don't know whether the seller was on a day pass or what. I don't see how you could possibly build a house for $10 a square foot.
Even in the States?
Even if you're given the land.
But the prices in California are way off, too, in many resort areas, are they not?
No, buying new property, of course, unless the developer's taking a hell of a loss, you can't build it for that. Right now, of course, houses can be bought for less than replacement.
Less than today's cost of replacement.
That's right.
Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yes.
Yes. I'm just wondering what he thinks of every time you look at the unemployment, it's going up every day on the papers and everything, where every day you look in the papers, thousands of people are losing their jobs. And these people are buying homes now, whether it's a good price at their 70s or 80s, where they might be in the same boat by losing their job, and prices coming down yet more.
What? I think that what's going to happen, you can see the turn in the States, and we really do depend so much on what happens in the United States. You know, they're our trading partner, where 70% of our goods are traded to the States, and if it turns there, their housing starts build up, our forestry sector and mining sector start building up, it's just a more secure situation. So I think that the corner's been turned and things will be better. So I wouldn't look to lose your job right now.
Yeah, but you're also not saying that now is the time, if you buy a house at, say, 107,000 average or 110,000 average, that you can sit back and watch it and sell it in 5 years for a fancy profit.
You know, you'll sell it for a profit, Jack, if in your situation, say if you bought a house for $60,000 4 years ago and put $10,000 in it, and even if it came down from 200 to 140, you know, you've gained, $90,000 on your $10,000 invested. So the gain is still fantastic if you lever, you know, and get proper financing.
Useful information from you. Kelly Heed, Senior Vice President of Macaulay, Nicolls, Maitland. See you again, Kelly.
Thank you, Jack.
Next, we're going to meet Flashman, George MacDonald Fraser. I first came to know George MacDonald Fraser by reputation when the general danced at dawn. What was the other army boot you wrote?
McCausland in the Rough.
McCausland in the Rough.
Aye.
Are you Polish?
Yes. How did you guess?
How did I guess? Before we get down to some other things, who is Flashman? How did you discover the biographies and the incredible adventures of a man who is now a cult figure, Flashman?
I discovered him in the pages of Tom Brown's School Days by Thomas Hughes, published, 1856?
Mm-hmm.
And he was such a good character, such a nasty bit of work, that when he went out of that book at the age of 17, vanished from sight, I thought, he's too good a man to lose.
So you rediscovered this. He's a kind of Walter Mitty person in fictional real life, if you can say such a thing.
In a sense, a very nasty Walter Mitty.
Tell me some of the things Flashman does in his incredible career, which hit the pinnacle of every adventuresome item that happened during his lengthy years of life.
He led the charge of the Light Brigade by accident. He was all through the Indian Mutiny by accident and very reluctantly. He was in the retreat from Kabul in 1840. He was with Custer at Little Bighorn. You name it, he did it.
Was he not too involved with the royal household in Sandringham one way or another?
Occasionally, yes, he was indeed. He had to take charge of a nephew of Queen Victoria's during the Crimean War and lost him.
And how many ranks did he hold in various armies?
Oh, incredible. Union Army in the American Civil War, Confederates, Colonel in the British Army. And quite a few irregular ones as well.
And when did he fictionally live unto? Because he spanned, must have been about 100 years of empire and American wartime activities.
Just about. I've said he was born in 1822 and died in 1915.
1822 and died in 1915. Have you come across anybody in real life that really patterned, after whom you patterned Flashman, or is this a boy's own paper character created with some savoir-faire, sophistication, and tongue-in-cheek couth?
The second. Yes. He is a boy's own paper hero turned upside down, mm-hmm. The seamy side.
Mm-hmm. It's quite a character. Are there any Flashman clubs around the world, or just people like myself who love to kind of put yourself in the position of Flashman?
There's a Flashman Society in London, whom I've never met, mm-hmm. And there's one in Winnipeg, I believe. They hold an annual dinner. I think there's one in India. There's a Flashman's bar in Monte Carlo named after him. That sort of thing.
Well, you never tempted yourself to dress and behave like Flashman? No, you did at one time, did you not?
I was put into uniform during the last war, yes. No, never been tempted.
Never been tempted to do that.
No.
It seems that we are kind of old friends by association. Tell me a little bit about George MacDonald Fraser.
Journalist in Glasgow?
You mean, no. George, a journalist I was taught in that same hallowed halls of the dirty old Glasgow Herald.
Aye.
Is a newspaper reporter out of a job. Now, what were you, a journalist or a newspaper reporter?
I was a newspaper sub-editor, features editor, leader writer, deputy editor, editor, everything but sweep the floor, you know.
How many years were you on the Glasgow Herald?
17, as far as I remember, yes.
And where did you start your newspaper and career?
Started it as a football reporter in Carlisle, in Cumberland, and then in Regina, on the Leader Post, as a crime reporter, police court. My wife was a reporter on the paper at the same time.
In the Regina Leader Post?
Yeah.
Oh, you married a Canadian?
No. We came to Canada together, although she had been brought up in Manitoba and Saskatchewan.
I understand, George MacDonald Fraser, and you're not required to answer this question unless you so wish, but you shall take the consequences if you do.
Aye.
That you have defected from the land of your birth for the purposes of tax.
I haven't defected from Scotland because I wasn't born there.
You weren't?
No, I was born in Carlisle.
Carlisle?
Aye.
Oh, the state pubs.
That's right, mm-hmm. Yes. I live in the Isle of Man because it's a beautiful place to live and has a beautiful rate of tax and that sort of thing, yeah.
Is the tax rate better than the weather?
Considerably.
Would
yes.
you care to tell, maybe 150, 200,000 people, what the rate of tax is in the Isle of Man?
20%, or 20 to 21%.
That's gross income declared.
That's flat.
That's flat. Yep. And you pay 20 to 21%.
Aye.
Did you have, not that you need it, but do you have the welfare state in the Isle of Man?
Yes. Yes, you do. It's the same as in Britain. Aye.
And Butland's holiday camps?
Not Butland's, but it's a great holiday island, as you know.
Well, George, have you killed Flashman off now in your final book? Where's the big book? Who's got
over
the big
here.
Book? Flashman and the Redskins.
No, by no means has he killed
him. You haven't killed him?
Oh, no.
What's the next Flashman? This brings him up, I read it through quickly, brings him up to the Battle of the Little Bighorn and Custer's Last Stand.
Aye.
What's the next Flashman going to cover?
Well, might be the American Civil War, might be the Riel Rebellion, I'm not sure.
Nobody knows where Flashman will appear.
Including me.
Your army books went very well, didn't they?
Yes, touch wood, they did.
The General Danced at Dawn. Many people have read them. I still keep it in one of the downstairs toilets over at the farm. So
that's the place for it.
Pick it up and read funny wee stories.
Aye.
George MacDonald Fraser, who's on partly because of nostalgia and partly because he's a very famous and highly successful author. I'm sorry you were born in Carlisle, to be racist.
Can't it be helped?
No. Can't it be helped? No. But your mother was Scotch.
Yes, and father.
And your father was
Scotch. Oh, everybody.
They might have crossed to Gretna Green.
No, my father was a Scots doctor, and the only place to go was England.
To make the money?
Aye.
George is going to be with me to the end of the program, and I'm going to have a free-for-all. But if you have any questions about Flashman, or to George, or to me, I'll take them now. There's a paucity of response from the callers this morning, George.
No wonder.
Do you think
I'm not a politician or a real estate man?
No. You're a delightful fellow. But how would you describe the moral character of this man, Flashman? And is it not a fact that he really is the telling of all of your secret repressed desires as a good square newspaper man who found the secret of writing books? Because this man was a rogue, a bounder, a liar, a scoundrel, a wastrel, and while this is a family program, he was a very erotic person who indulged in all kinds of feats of sexual derring-do. Do you not feel it's a little bit of your own subconscious, the Flashman thing, coming to the surface?
No, not really. He's deplorable, you know, but an awful lot of people identify with him.
Yeah.
For some reason or other, they say that's how we would behave.
If you had the power and the luck.
And the luck, they think that in perilous situations they would run away too. I'm not so sure they would, actually.
Well, he was a coward too.
Oh, too right.
He didn't run away from Custer's last stand, Flashman, did he?
He did his best.
What did he do? How did he get away from Custer's last stand?
He was actually picked up on the battlefield of an apparently mangled corpse, but he wasn't.
And
he survived.
He managed to escape. When were you last in the offices of the Glasgow Herald?
Oh.
Which you're a graduate many years back.
Aye.
How old are you, George?
57.
Don't look a day more than 56.
Thank you.
My standard crack. 57.
That'll be about 7 or 8 years ago.
Is it still the old stodgy paper it was?
They've brightened it. They've got news on the front page.
They took the ads off the front page?
They took the ads off the front page, but it's moved house. It's gone to another part of Glasgow.
Yeah, I know. I used to go into that place in the afternoon. I was the office boy to David Willock, the editor of the Glasgow Evening Times, and I made my first shilling writing a feature, somebody might spot it out here, called Gossip and Grumbles.
Oh, I remember that.
In the Evening Times.
Uh-huh.
Then I worked for Hedderwick of the Bulletin, and I worked for Robinson, was it, of the Glasgow Herald?
Sir William.
And if I named one name by the name of Phillips, would he still be around?
He's retired now, but he's just written a history of the Herald for its 200th anniversary, and my first job when I go home is to review it.
When you go home?
Aye.
You're still to review it? Okay, any calls? Must be some calls. Where do I go? I don't want one. This is a... Oh, he's on Flashman. Go ahead to George MacDonald Fraser, Flashman.
Yes, Jack, I think... Hello?
That's you, yeah.
Yeah, I think that Mr. Fraser... He mentioned the Louis Rebellion. I think a good script for his story is taking an investigative reporter such as you doing a story on the Real Rebellion.
I am neither a bounder, a liar, a rogue, maybe a coward, but that's something else again. And I hope not to be a wastrel, but the Real Rebellion. Who's ever heard of it outside of Canada?
Oh, a lot of people.
Have you heard of it, George?
Well, I know about it. Mind you, I lived in Saskatchewan, so... Yes, I would think it's fairly well known, but even if it wasn't, the idea is to make it well known.
Well, Mr. Fraser, if you used a real Scotch reporter, investigating reporter in the Real Rebellion, because there was lots of Scotchmen around there in those days.
One or two.
Oh, I tell you, I've met many. Yes, I won't tell that story. Thanks anyway. Consider the Real Rebellion, but put yourself in it, because it's you that's in Flashman.
You think so?
Oh, I'm sure of it.
Thank you.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, Jack.
Yes.
Do you know that in the States we've got Reagan?
Yeah.
We've got Johnny Cash?
Right.
We got Hope, I should say, and we got Johnny Cash.
Right.
Here we've got Bennett. We've got no Hope and no Cash.
Bennett is the provincial premier.
I gather, yes.
That's a little joke he's making. That would do for Gossip and Grumbles in the old days.
Not bad, eh?
Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yeah.
Mr. Fraser, I want to thank you for your book, The General's Danced at Dawn. Well, with reservations. I read it in, I think it was 1975,
I was in the Lionsgate Hospital having my gallbladder out, and my God, I laughed so much I nearly burst the stitches, and it hurt. So it really, it was an enjoyable book. And I do enjoy Flashman too, but that one really made me laugh.
Thank you very much.
Personally, I think that was a great book too. Go ahead, please.
Oh, hello. I tried to get through yesterday, but I wasn't able to. And I'd like to make a couple of comments, and that is on education. On professional days, I suggest you get a hold of Marvin Medina up at Simon Fraser, who has done a great deal of studying and research into in-service education. I've done some myself. Some of the things that I've found is your one-day professional days are excellent for exchange of ideas, and what we should be looking at is not decreasing the professional days, but increasing the professional days.
Hear, hear. The children should be left alone in the classrooms more often.
Pardon? I can't hear you.
The children should be left alone in the classrooms more often. It's like what I say.
No, I don't think they should.
Just a moment, please. I always welcome medical strikes, because when doctors strike, far fewer people die.
I don't know.
No. And any of my doctors are listening, I am only joking. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Mr. Webster.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Do you have any idea where I can get the books of your sister-in-law, Jan Webster?
Do you know I have a famous sister-in-law,
yes,
Jan
indeed.
Webster? She wrote Saturday City, Beggar Man's Treat. What was the other? Collier's Row?
Uh-huh.
Oh, any good store will get you Jan Webster's books.
In Canada?
Yes, yes. They're widely sold by Collins. Collins is
Collins
the publisher. Eh?
Collins Bookstore?
No, Collins the publisher.
Oh, okay.
Any, just tell them Webster sent you and they'll get the books. Do you happen to know Jan?
No, never met him.
Did you know my brother Sandy?
I knew Sandy well, aye.
Did you hear the wee story about him dying this summer?
I'm afraid I did.
I told you that this morning.
You did that?
There was a very funny postscript. Will I tell you?
Aye.
Ach, maybe I shouldn't.
Go on.
Will I?
Ach, aye.
He died very suddenly, and it was an unexpected death. And there was one very nice little touch. I think the name of the pub was the Balduffy Pub, near Gouchcroft, Dunfoot Air. And the arrangements were made very quickly. I couldn't go over anyway. And the local pub, I think it's the Balduffy Pub, put on the wake at their expense. Teas and refreshments purveyed by the pub. Isn't that not nice?
Very nice, very nice. And Sandy would have appreciated that. He used to describe himself as the president of the Glasgow Freeloaders Society. I remember.
That's good. He used to belong to Titwood Cricket Club, I know
he
that.
He did, that's right.
The president of the Glasgow Freeloaders Society.
That's right.
Oh, he was keeping up the Webster Flashman family tradition. Go ahead, please.
Hello. I would just like to thank Mr. Fraser for the enjoyment that my family and I have had with his books. I would also like him to settle an argument for us. We were arguing last week on whether Flashman, if he got his idea from Tom Brown's school days, you know, the ripping yarn sort of thing, the bully in Tom Brown's school days.
Oh, yes.
I thought maybe he was part of that character, but my sons insist he's not.
No, you're absolutely right. You win,
right?
And
oh, good, because we've argued and argued and argued about it.
So really, he is your reincarnation of the
exactly.
The bounder and the bully from Tom Brown's school days.
That's it.
Mind you, he was only mentioned in Tom Brown's school days.
That's right. Just about 40 pages and he was out.
Mm-hmm.
Killed off.
But reading your books, he reminds me very much of the Flashman in Tom Brown's school days.
Oh, yes.
Oh, thank you very much. I'll tell my sons the next time I see them.
Good. Thank you very much. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Jack.
Morning.
I'm sorry, but I'm really sitting here and I am killing myself laughing because I think to myself, this is one Scotsman against another. And after what we've heard all week, nothing but misery and mortgages going up and what have you, it's so funny. I'm sitting here and I'm just dying. Just with a dry humour.
Well, I'm going to make you laugh. I'm going to make you laugh again. I don't think I've ever told this story on the air. My wife will be furious at me, but I'm going to tell it. So just listen. When Grandpa, who was it? Edgar was dying. He lived at 438 Cathcart Road. And it was during the war. And my mother and father raced over. And they climbed up the tenement stairs to the top room where old Grandpa Edgar, he was 84, was breathing his last. He said to my mother, "There's one thing I want." "What's that?" she said. "A copy of the Sunday Mail." So my wife goes away down the stairs, goes back up to the Sunday Mail and says, "What do you want to know, Dad?" He said, "What won the 230 entry yesterday?" She told him, he said, "Damn it, I lost side and dad." Matter of fact, Sandy told that story on the interview I brought back from, I had the three Webster brothers on the air last year, the Webster boys on Fleet Street, because we all worked there at one time. Give my regards to anybody who remembers any Websters in Glasgow.
Oh, well, indeed.
And don't put me in your next Flashman book. And I'll be back after the break. Monday morning, I've got to face up to one of the big wheels from Ottawa, Jean Chrétien, who'd switched to become the new energy minister, and he's going to try and defend this bailout of the bankrupt dome and the rescue lifeline for the banks who were so unwise in their investments in the dome operation. That's for sure, Monday. What else? We'll be here anyway. Webster with Jean Chrétien, Monday at 9 a.m. precisely. Are you in favor of splitting Western Canada from the present federal state? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Hi, Mom!
There was one celebrated roof somewhere which, because of the heat from the bodies and the breaths of 80,000 spectators, rained on the people inside. Will this one rain on the people inside? Thankless task, isn't it, leader of the NDP?
No, it's not.
Always the bridesmaid, never the bride.
No, these wonderful phrases. The bride's day will come.
Your opposition's a fellow, what's his name?
Jonathon.
Jonathon what?
Jonathon Half Baker, you mean?